One more announcement as we begin, I'm sorry. There are some study guides like there were last week. If you'd like those, our ushers are ready right now to hand those out to assist you in worshiping God today. We'll let them pass those out for a moment here. Dear friends, I invite you to stand as we begin. Lord, we begin in your name, the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord. And he will teach us his ways.
So that we will walk in his paths.
Come, people of God, let us walk in the light of the Lord. We have come into the presence of God who created us to love him and to serve him as his own dear children. But we have disobeyed him, and we deserve only his wrath, only his punishment. Therefore, let us be honest with God this morning. Let's confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy as we sing together.
Lord, I am ruined. I have left you. I need rescue. Lord, I am pleading. Show your favor. Be my Savior. I love your law and would walk well within it.
Lord, I desire. This is the soul of my grace and redeeming.
God, our Heavenly Father has heard your call for mercy, and he answered in love beyond measure. God gave his one and only Son, Jesus Christ, whose blood purifies us from all sin. God's holy wrath has been satisfied once and for all. As a child of God, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, trust in your Savior, knowing that all your sins are forgiven and your guilt is removed. In the certainty and the joy of this forgiveness, let all God's people say, Amen.
Lord, I was ruined, having left you.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your mercy and grace may always go before and follow after us, that loving you with undivided hearts, we may be ready for every good and useful work through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. God's grace, God's peace, may they be yours, just yours, in full abundance through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. The church seems to be dying. What can we do to save it? Ever hear that question before? Sounds like a all too familiar question these days around the world. The Christian church, people are asking that question. They look at it and they seem to, well, they want to save it. Wouldn't be surprised if we hear that even here among God's people, right? It's a very serious question, a very urgent question, but it reminds me of a lighthearted or a lighter-sided show on TV called Restaurant Impossible. Ever heard of that show before? It's a show about restaurants which are failing and they're flailing, and in a last-ditch effort to save the restaurant, they hire a professional to come in to diagnose the problem, give them some strategies and tactics. Maybe say, this is what a restaurant could look like, would look like, if it served to its potential. And it's kind of interesting to watch the show. Some of those restaurants are just a mess. Whether it's the menu, that they're serving the wrong kind of food to the people, or the owner of the restaurant's holding on to the traditions of Ma and Pa, who gave the restaurant down to them. Or maybe it's even the wait staff. They just got bad attitudes, and they're scaring away the customers. But you know, oftentimes, the problem stems from the restaurant not knowing its true identity, knowing its individual purpose, and not knowing that causes confusion for everybody involved. And it's easy for a Christian congregation to be the same way. When a Christian congregation, when God's church doesn't know its true identity, its purpose, it causes confusion for everyone involved. But the difference is that we don't go to the world for words of wisdom and tactics and strategies. We go to the Word for spiritual wisdom and strength. The church, all she needs to do is always look to her Lord and His Word and not ask the question, what kind of church do we want to be? But what kind of church would our God have us be? May God give us wisdom and joy as He gives us and helps us fulfill our purpose in His very word to the prophet Isaiah this morning. I invite you to turn to that section of Scripture. We'll also have it on the screen here. And I invite you to follow along in that meditation folder. There's notes and there's questions for you to consider. Maybe even later in your day or in your week, you can answer those as an individual or a couple. You can do it right now as well. Isaiah chapter 2. This is what Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and all nations will stream to it. Many peoples will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us His ways so that we may walk in His paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord. This is God's word. Boy, what a beautiful picture God paints of us in that text, isn't it? Did you catch that? That's us. The vision that God gave the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, 2,700 years ago, wasn't a picture of what the church could be many years from now. Wasn't a picture of the church's potential, a fantasy vision of what it might look like. What Isaiah saw was God's church right now. He saw a picture of you 2,700 years ago. This is the true and the glorious picture of God's church. Isaiah saw a vision of Judah and Jerusalem. That's God's people. The people believe in God. And he saw a picture of them in the last days, it says, right? The last days is a phrase that the Bible uses to describe the time from after Jesus all the way until the last day of the earth. So that's right now. The last days is 2015, in the year of our Lord, the last days. This is what Isaiah was looking at. And what Isaiah saw right here, what he saw was it's the church. He saw the church at its very heart and core, what makes up the church of God. And notice in his vision now what he doesn't see. Isaiah didn't see any council meetings. Isaiah didn't see any circle groups. Isaiah didn't see any garage sales, soup suppers, potluck dinners. Isaiah didn't even see any buildings. He didn't even hear any music or see any services. What did he see? He saw people. Isaiah saw people, people and people streaming to God, and he saw God living with his people. He saw the church. That's what church is, and that's what you and I are. Isaiah saw a picture of God's temple on top of Mount Moriah. But then he saw that temple rising up to be the highest mountain in the entire world, higher than anything else in the entire world. The temple was the place where God's people met with God. They came together to be with God, and by the shedding of the blood of an innocent lamb or a goat, they would receive full forgiveness from all their sins, and they would hear just how much God loves them. And Isaiah said, in the last days, that mountain, that message, would rise up and become the most glorious and become the most wonderful. The thing that would delight people the very most, the most important message in the entire world, it would rise like Mount Everest above every other mountain in the world. That's what God saw there. And he saw more and more people streaming to that mountain, to that message of Jesus, a Savior, forgiving the sins of the world. And he said, that's church. I guess it's important for us to ask ourselves today, is that what God sees when he looks at this church? Right? Is the most important or the tallest mountain here at St. John's, the mountain that rises above everything else we do, is it that message of a Savior lifted high on a cross for the sins of all people? Or might God sometimes see little hills and bluffs slowly scraping and scratching and clawing their way to try to rise up to the same height as God's holy mountain? Might he see the hills, the grassy knolls of finances, or maybe the bluffs of church membership slowly rising, ascending and descending? Maybe he'll look down and see a whole mountain range of mountains going up and down in any given day. Or what about the people of the world? When they look at our church here, do they see one mountain standing taller than everything else in their community and everything else in this church? Do they see the cross of Jesus offering them forgiveness for all their sins? Or might they be confused by seeing a number of different mountains at times? Maybe they see us as the church of traditions, or the old and stuffy church, or the church with the Ten Commandments, or the church where people might complain and squabble with each other, or et cetera, and on and on. Friends, if you look at God's church and you're tempted to see it as a weak and a lowly and a self-deflating thing, a dying and outdated thing, if the people of the world look at God's church and they're tempted to see it as a church about members and money and growth and politics, then we're not seeing the church that God sees. Do you want to see that church? Do you want to be that church? Then let's ask God for help. Let's ask God to help us this morning, by first asking him to help us see us as we really are, right? Like we did in our song at the beginning of worship, we ask God, Lord, show me through your word who I really am. I'm not afraid to say it. I am a sinner. Lord, have mercy on us. And let's not shy away from saying that, yes, we have walked away from the Lord and his ways at times, and we have not been the beacon of light that stands tall and high above everything else in the world. Lord, we confess what we are. But Lord, show us who you are, that we may see again and remember to see Christ high and lifted up as a Savior for our sins. And then to see the church born from that very message, from the water with the word. To hear those very words come out of Jesus' mouth when he said in John 12, when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. To hear it in the Apostle Paul's words, I am not ashamed of the gospel. That's the power of God for the salvation of everyone. Dear friends, this is the church. When people gather around that one message, that one cross lifted high on that one mighty mountain, that's church. Church is not a place, it's an activity. And when we gather around that beautiful message, God says, you are my church. You are my people. And you are fulfilling your purpose, because then that mountain will rise more and more as the people of the world see it and stream to it. And soul by soul, block by block, the church will rise higher and higher. Dear friends, may God grant us that we fulfill our purpose, simply to lift high the cross, to gather around that cross, to live under that cross, and to hold it high as a beacon of light, as a city on a hill, so the world can see it and stream to it. God grant that for us here at St. John's. Amen. Let's respond by singing that beautiful hymn, Lift High the Cross.
A few years ago, back when I was living in Michigan, there was big buzz in the town of Otsego. That's because a new business was coming to town. That is big news, right? You know how it goes in a small town. There's two kinds of businesses that always come to town, right? There's either a restaurant or an auto parts store, it seems like. We like to eat and we like to fix our cars. So big buzz in Otsego, Michigan. And you know how the buzz goes. It was building with every detail that got released. We found out that it was going to be a Mexican restaurant. And then we found out it was going to be an offshoot of a popular restaurant in the big city. And then we looked at the building, and wow, things were really taking shape. And then we saw the logo on the sign. It was really cool. So when it opened, guess what? You got to go. So we went. And when we walked in the doors, and the dining area was the size of the comfort room around the corner. And then we went to the counter to order. We didn't know it was that kind of restaurant. When we ordered, it took a half an hour to get 5 burritos. We took them home, and we tried to make this big deal about how great these burritos were, but as we took the last bite, we decided, you know, there's really nothing special about these burritos, and I'm still hungry. So guess what happened after that? We didn't go back, and we didn't recommend the restaurant to anybody. And I think that was the the case for everybody who visited because the restaurant closed in 6 months. So it just kind of, that whole experience just solidified some of what Pastor Zimpelman was saying, a key truth in life, that if there's no substance to an entity, if an entity does not meet the biggest need, the need for which the entity is designed, it's pretty worthless. It's going to fail. And you probably have stories about restaurants or businesses that you visited, and unfortunately that's happened to them too. But as we were just hearing, as we look at this scripture today from Isaiah 2, God says that that is also true about church. I'd like to take a look at those verses again. If you could read for me the verses underlined when we get to those. So come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord. The law will go out from Zion.
The word of the Lord from Jerusalem.
So as you look at those verses, the substance of God's church, what God's church is all about is the word of the Lord and instruction in that. The reason that people stream into God's church is what Pastor Zimpelman was talking about. The reason people stream into God's church is because of instruction. Continuing, ongoing instruction and growth in the saving, loving ways of the Lord. That's the purpose of God's church, to instruct. That's the passion of God's church, to grow. That's the life of God's church, living in the Word of God. So when that is going on in a church, when people are being instructed, when teaching is going on, when learning is going on, that amazing pattern of what Isaiah talks about happens. When instruction is happening, that's when people stream into God's church. Not necessarily numerically in each individual congregation, but through instruction, the gospel is the power of God for the salvation of people who believe. That's how God gathers believers. And then, the awesome thing is too, when instruction is going on, when people are growing, then people go forth into the world with the Word of God. Instruction in the Word is what church is all about. So, what happens in a congregation when that is not happening, when instruction and ongoing learning is not happening, when people are not streaming in and people are not going forth? Can we be that bad restaurant that we heard about? I want to ask some very penetrating questions in this meditation. And it's not my intention with these questions to disparage or criticize. We are all a team in St. John's, and we all focus on the same place. But I guess I don't want this meditation to be the same old sermon routine where you kind of listen and, okay, yep. I want you to think. I want you to examine what we do as a congregation in St. John's. So I'll start out with an easy question, I guess. What is the most important thing we do? What is our congregation all about? God's Word, right? We just read it. Of course you're going to say the right thing. But here's where the challenge comes in. And here's where I want you to be painfully honest, including myself. What occupies your mind the most when you think about or you talk about St. John's? So it's Sunday afternoon after church, or it's Tuesday evening, and you're with fellow members and you're talking about St. John's. What's always the topic of conversation? Is it the lessons from Sunday? Is it the sermon that was preached on Sunday? Is it the Bible class you attended, or is it something else? Whatever you answered, you don't have to tell me right now, but whatever you answered, whether you like it or not, deep down that's what you believe is the focus of the congregation. I'll start out. I'll confess my sins first. I tend to think, it's just the way I think, in spaces, spatially. I tend to look at gospel ministry very often through the lens of how things look. Is it appealing and attractive? Is it open and flowing? Is it modern? Does it serve the needs? And yet I look at God's Word and God says, you know what, Pastor? That's not what causes people to stream into church. So there's my painful confession. What were you thinking? What occupies your mind the most? Is it finances, as we talked about? Do you tend to think of gospel ministry at St. John's through the lens of the budget or the weekly offering? What comes in? How much things cost? God tells us in Isaiah that's not what causes people to stream into his church. Was it something else like the way we do things? Do you tend to look at gospel ministry through the lens of tradition and rituals, or this nice, neat box of how I think things should go in church? The way a pastor dresses and moves, what technologies we use or we don't, what the music sounds like, how the service goes. God says that's not what causes people to stream into his church. Because it's something else. The groups we're a part of, or the confirmation certificate on the wall, or the Christian way to do it. God says that's not what causes people to stream into his church. Go back to the word. Let's read together the underlined words again. He will teach us his ways. Instruction. Learning. Growing in God's word is what it is all about. And it's amazing what that does. I want you to think about that in light of all the things that usually occupy our mind. This is amazing when you think about it. Whether or not the weekly offerings are meeting the expected needs, whether the number in the checkbook is a high number or a low number, it doesn't change the most important fact that God sent us a Savior to fully pay the debt of our failures and our sin and our guilt. Whether or not things are done the way we've always done them, or current circumstances call for a change. Whether things fit nicely into our box of what church is, or if it's out of the box or it stretches that box a little bit, it doesn't change the most important thing that happens here. Talking about and learning about the good news that the Savior who gave his life took it back again, and he's alive. So I have an encouragement for you. As you get in our groups and we start talking on Sunday afternoon or Tuesday evening about St. John's and what goes on here, and we get into those same conversations like I do about worship spaces, maybe just somebody pause and say, Jesus is alive and so is my salvation. That's what it's about. Because then all of a sudden you realize, you know what, my hope, my joy, my comfort, my guidance, my peace, it doesn't rest on any of that stuff. It rests solely on the historic fact that Jesus lived, and he died, and he rose again, and he ascended into heaven, and he's coming back for me. Nothing else that goes on here is as important as growing in that. And so that really does just change everything if we approach everything from that line of thinking. It refocuses us. And I know, just like me when I was preparing for this sermon, boy, it kind of gets you on edge. This is important to me. Those are important. But at the same time, it shouldn't make us mad. It should excite us. It should fire us up with purpose and passion to not just do church, but to really be the church. And I think that happens in three important ways. I just want to quickly list these at the end here. Number one. Knowing what it's all about, it helps us to look at everything through the lens of growing in the gospel, the good news about Jesus. Rather than the mindset, and I'll use some examples of what I used before, rather than thinking, well, good stewardship, that equals good ministry. No, we flip it around. Gospel ministry leads to good stewardship. Or what was the other example? Rather than thinking, well, the right way to do things, that equals good ministry. No, we flip it around. Gospel ministry leads to the things that we do. And we plug everything into that line of thinking. The second thing, it helps us to really refocus and align everything with what's most important. Growing in instruction, as we talked about in the passage there. It means we are able to joyfully examine everything we do and make sure everything we do connects people to what causes people to grow the gospel of Jesus. Sometimes we have to clear some things away. Sometimes we have to remove some obstacles, but we align everything with growing in the gospel. And then the third thing is very important. We will become a place where everyone continues in instruction. Young and old, new or long-standing, because that really is the force behind the word God uses in Isaiah when he says he will teach. It's an ongoing action without an end. There's progression there. There's movement. And we want that to be true of everyone who is a part of St. John's. Always growing. Not shrinking, of course, and not staying the same from confirmation until death. Growing in our knowledge and faith. And that happens all through the sacrament and through the word, the gospel of Jesus. And so it's really simple when you look at God's word, isn't it? We can be a bad restaurant, having everything going on except the substance of what really matters, or we can be the church. Be a part of the church that God describes in Isaiah, where the substance of what we are is the most important thing there is, where the very thing that we're about is the thing that causes people to stream in and causes people to go forth, growing in the word of God. May God shape us into that through his word. Amen. I invite you to please stand. Let's confess our faith with Luther's explanation to the third article of the Apostles' Creed on page 8 of the service folder. I believe that I cannot, by my own thinking or choosing, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. In the same way he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In the Christian church, he daily and richly forgives all my sins and the sins of all believers. On the last day, he will raise me and all the dead and give eternal life to me and all believers in Christ. This is most certainly true. I'd like to just take a moment to prepare our hearts. There's a silent prayer of preparation there on page 8 as we prepare ourselves to receive the Lord's Supper. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated. Just a reminder, we will come forward like we usually do, and we will line up with the baptismal font, and the elements will be distributed there. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as we thank Jesus for this beautiful gift of forgiveness and love. God has taught us today that our purpose as God's church is to come and gather around that word so we can lift it up, and that people of all around the world would stream to the very message of forgiveness that you and I just received. Today, God has told us that our purpose as a church is to gather around that word so we can grow and be instructed in the ways of the Lord as we just have been today. And God says as his people gather around the word and lift up that word and grow in that word, well then the third purpose, your purpose as my church, will be carried out in you as well. Or as Isaiah said, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Let us live our faith. Let us love as Jesus did. What does that look like? Well, Isaiah gave us, again, a picture of that as he saw a vision. Remember, he saw a vision of you, God's church, living out their faith, being that light on a hill. I invite you to look at verses 3, 4, and 5 once again in your worship folder. Isaiah saw the law going out from Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord. What does that mean? As God's people walk in the light of the Lord, God says that they will naturally want to live that light of the Lord. And Isaiah says, here's some ways that naturally shows in your life. He says, God will judge between the nations and the peoples and settle their disputes. Now, what that doesn't mean, as God's people come together and live in that word and grow in that word, that they start getting judgmental with each other. What God does mean, as they grow around that word, they will hold that word up as the real truth of what is right and wrong. And God's word will settle disputes, and he will judge what is correct. And friends, as you and I are around that word, we will lovingly do that for each other too. Is it always easy? No. But as you live your faith, that might mean a Christian congregation lovingly says to one of its members or someone, you know, I know the world says it's okay to drink like that, but that's not God's will for you. Come, let's walk in the light of the Lord together. You know, I know your reason tells you it's okay to live together before you're married and have sex before marriage. But that's not God's will for your life. Would you come and walk in the light of the Lord with us? And I know right now in your life it seems like the weekends are made, specifically made for vacations and sleeping in and rest. I know that, but we love you enough. We love you. We don't want to let the most important rest in your life, your faith rest, be neglected and lost, eventually losing your salvation. And so we encourage you, come, continue to walk with us in the light of the Lord. What else does Isaiah say living in your faith as a congregation will look like? He says, well, nations will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation. They won't train for war anymore. As God's people gather around the world, will that heal every single war out there? No. That's not what God means. But God's word will be the power to heal in this congregation. God's word will be the power that allows us to forgive each other just as we were forgiven in Christ. God's word will be the power that allows us to love each other, care for each other, and provide for each other just as you and I have been so richly provided for in Christ. Your friends, as you're seeing this now play out, God says, live in the light of the Lord. Is it an easy thing to do? No. Living your faith is not an easy thing to do, but God says it's a natural thing. Dear Christians, you are the church, and the natural life of the church is to live the faith and to walk in the light of the Lord. Just like a power plant, Jesus is that nuclear power plant of the world, right? He's the life source, the energy source, and through faith, he has plugged you into himself. His congregation is tapped in, the feeder line of faith. God says it's natural. I turned you on. My electricity and my strength flows through you, through the word and the sacrament. Go be lights. Go live. Be the vision that Isaiah saw. Let's be the church that God has made us to be. Church is not a building. Church is an activity. Church is God's people gathering around his word. Church is God gathering with his people. Let's be those people who are a city on top of a hill, right? A hill that rises and becomes the mightiest mountain in the world. Let's be that beacon of light that the rest of the world can see. And what is that beacon of light? Well, it's not what we do. It's not who we are. But really, it's what's on top of that mountain. On top of the mountain of the Lord stands a cross. A single cross, God's banner of love. The flag on top of the mountain, the highest mountain in the world. Come, people of God, let us gather around the cross of Christ and lift it high for the world to see it. Come, people of God, let us gather around the cross of Christ and his word to grow and be strengthened and nourished. Come, people of God, let us walk in the light of the Lord and be the church that God has made us to be. God bless us as we do. Amen. May the peace of God, which transcends our human understanding, may it guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. One way that we can live our faith and show our thanks to God is by bringing him our first fruit offerings to carry out the ministry of the gospel in this place and around the world. We do that at this time. invite you to stand as we honor God by entrusting to Him our prayers and requests. We pray as a family, as a church of God. Almighty God, we praise you and we honor your holy name for the numerous acts of love and mercy that you've shown on behalf of your people. We especially thank you for the gift of your one and only Son, who has ascended into heaven and sits at your right hand. And we rejoice in the knowledge that he is our advocate before your throne, and he intercedes for us for all of our needs. Therefore, send your Holy Spirit to enlighten our minds with understanding and with knowledge of your heavenly truths. Give to all who serve your holy church a full measure of your grace, that Jesus may be confessed, that his cross may be lifted high, that his gospel may be declared as the only way to eternal life. Lord, bless all parents as they may be wholesome examples to their children. May they teach their children to love you, and to practice virtue, to walk in the light of the Lord and pursue instruction in your word and serve your church and all the people. Hear also the prayers of all who are afflicted in the quiet hour of the night when they are weighed down with pain or loneliness and anxiety. Bring them strength and hope by assuring them that your love endures, your power overcomes, your presence remains constant. As we leave this hour of worship, we give you all glory, Jesus. To you be praise and honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And hear us, Lord, as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we sing our next hymn, printed on page 11. We are a chosen people, a holy nation, that we may declare the praises of Him
who called us out of darkness.
Come, people of God, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Amen. And as you do, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you His peace.